Okay, so yeah, there is no special announcement, or you will do it, yeah.
No, if you prefer to start without an announcement, because it's the second lecture, okay?
Yeah. Yeah, so in principle, I was stopped in a half word the last time, and so I continue from this point as one of the professor when I was a student, who dictate all, gave all statement with the syntaxes and so on. And sometimes he enter in the big hole, did comma. So it means that it does not make it comma in the last time, it continued to it's not the same, but almost. So a little recalling, however, so we are about the Riemann, more justice is Euler zeta function, but it's zero. And so I introduce this notation. The basic formula is here. There is no indicator how to indicate it. There is, it's not the same. There is. This is the basic. Oh, I don't like it. It is the basic formula here, which is the basis of all business about Niemann's and Berlin's approach. This is the Fourier transform for multiplicative group of positive numbers, and it acts like this, the unitary, in unitary manner. And I recall the Neumann theorem where I stopped and proved it. So the Riemann conjecture that the zeros of zeta function all on the critical line real part equal to 1/2, if and only if this approximation is possible. So the function, the constant function 1, can be approximated by linear combinations of the dilations of function phi. Function phi of phi was defined before. So phi of x, I recall it is the fractional part of 1 over x. All what is the same, so this family of functions are complete on the whole space L2, because the constant is the cyclic function, which is of the dilation group, which is very easy. Here is the scheme of the proof, what I made in details. So this is just to recall you that the main ingredient is the Berlin characterization of invariant subspaces and the computation of the corresponding inner function. What I stopped really, this is this statement which I gave mistakenly. I mean the quantitative version of Neumann theorem, which I gave in some paper in 1905. So it is two new parameters, s, the number of the right-hand half plane, and the positive gamma. And we consider these weighted differences, which I considered in Neumann theorems, too, and consider this distance of this function, which this power, which is not related to this parameter gamma, they are free. And so it is not a d gamma of s. And then the disk free of zeros is here. And in particular, so this is the Blaschke product centered at s. S star I used already. This is the symmetric point with respect to the imaginary axis here. And so this is some disk here, which I described with radius in the center. And exactly for this statement, I make some calculation what I mentioned the last time, just in my telephone, really. It does not depend the very big for S, the imaginary part of S equal to 3. And with S equal to, I forget, 2 or 3 half, and it gives better left point than in Nagradov-Korobov, very, very complicated estimate. So it is, however, curious. Anyway, okay. And then so I continue. Now my goal is to arrive to some statement equivalent to Riemann conjecture or related in some other way, which is suitable for applying the very powerful techniques from several complex variables. And unfortunately, there will be a gap. I already mentioned it. We approach to this gap. But I will follow, however, the evolution. I will not mention all papers, all results published during the hundreds, 150 years starting from Riemann hypothesis, but I will mention all important results related to approximation approach, to links to approximation. The next one is the Berling theorem in 55, so 5 years after his PhD student Niemann, who proved that the same equivalence is true for approximation in LP, not only in L2. But I'd like to say, I will comment a little bit later on, that this result technically is completely different of the case p equal to 2, because it, in fact, dilations on the positive half line, this is the same that translation on the line into LP, there is no result. And there is no description of invariant subspaces, nor even shadow of the theorem of Berling about the description. It's much, much more complicated and free fields to apply some efforts. And but however, Berling used some his previous result about completeness of translations, and so he succeeded to prove this. So it is some, if p is less than 2, and it is less than 2 in interesting case, so it should be. But here, as in Niemann theorem, the situation is that for the proof of this, say, of the sufficiency of condition, there is no technique. It's very simple, really. And even here, the necessity is very complicated. But to decide whether the approximation holds true, it's absolutely impossible, even if it is known. Even if it is now, it is not impossible, but complicated. Even here, say for p equal to what to no, he is not in Berlin, but in the next one there is the cases where you know that the completeness is true, but cannot see it because there is no zeros of zeta function. And the next one is Levinson, just after, in 56, who considered not normed, not LP, but multi-normed space defined by two parameters, sigma 1, sigma 2, which are here from 1/2 to 1, and considering the norms which are here and all functions for which all these norms are finite when a, b vary on this interval sigma 1 and sigma b, you can understand that this power plays different roles in 0 and infinity. And so he proved that zeta function has no zeros in this strip here if and only if this space H is generated by the dilations, and the difference from Neeman, Berling and many others after is that he considered not all dilations but just arbitrary but sufficiently many such that this series diverges. It is nothing more than Blaschke condition for a half plane, and in the proof it is used as Blaschke condition. The proof is that he, with the help of this Blaschke condition, he reduced the completeness of this dilation to the completeness of all dilations, and by the uniqueness theorem and estimate of scalar product of function orthogonal to these dilations. And then so used the theorem type Wiener-Tauberian theorem. If lambda, if the dilation is arbitrary positive dilation, so it is already. What is of interest of course that the proof is very technical here, as all in Berlin, huh? There is no. What is interest that the two weights are important. If you fix one A equal to B, but arbitrary, but just one, it is quite simple to see that the completeness is true. It quite simple means in the Berling style, one page and half and a half of quite strong computations, but however not as a proof of the principal theorem. Okay, the activity continue, and so the result, what is important for this talk, is the exactly in the Berling style. I mean, the difference is that the space is a metric Fréchet space and not Hilbert space, and that he considered the not all dilations but only some dilations with lambda n which do not satisfy the Blaschke condition. And here also lambda n equal to n, it is not Blaschke, of course, the series 1 over n diverges. And but however, the necessity in the Hilbert space, this is the novice of Baez Duarte, who proved in 93 that this is equivalent. I mean, not that the span is equal to the whole space L2, this is not true. This is the infinite codimensional subspace of L2, this span, which is very easy to see. But the constant belongs, can be approximated by linear combinations of entire dilations if the Riemann hypothesis is true. In the other direction, it is of course obvious. So now I will comment it a little bit, exactly what I promised. So related to Berling theorem and two Berling theorems, and for LP and with the frequencies with the dilations, which is subset of all possible dilations. So the general problem is here. You have some subset, countable not, sequence or not, and you look for criteria for completeness or cyclicity, this is synonymous, in the space LP of the dilations of a given function f. Of course, you can consider more general problem, say, to look to describe Sperling made for Niemann, to describe all invariant subspaces with respect to these dilations. But this is usually much more complicated. And for L2, it was a chance. It was a coincidence of many, many circumstances. And so the same question for LP on the semigroup of 0, 1, and 1 infinity. And the same, of course, for the translation, which is equivalent to this statement because of the change in, exponential change of variable. If you take x equal to y to the e to y, so you will change the group of positive number to the real line. And so I will denote this set of frequencies of this dilations lambda, and in additive setting by logarithm lambda, lambda star. So the answer to this problem, to this question, is known only for p equal to 2 and lambda equal to this one. Maybe you can find something with very, very small variations, but I doubt, I not remember any complete answers to this problem. For the case of the group dilation here, for the group, no, I'm sorry, not dilation, but for the case of the group translation, lambda star, it is on the real line. So there is the result. There is my old result of 1972. Most of you was not already planned or born. Okay, when I proved that it is there exists a cyclic for entire translations or a half of entire translations, if and only if in LP. If and only if p is bigger than 2. Then, independently, the result by completely different method was discovered by Aharon Atzman and Alexander Alevsky in 1997. And moreover, in my paper, or in a subsequent paper, there is a criteria, if you want. So if you consider some space X which satisfies some condition, say the lattice of measurable functions on the real line in between of L1 and infinity, or not, it is not necessary. Then the criteria is that you consider a subset, a subspace of this space which consists of functions constant on this interval, so the step functions. And this will be the sequence space, Banach sequence space. And the necessary and sufficient condition of the existence of this cyclic vector is that this space is not embedded into L2, that it is larger, and so the norm is weaker. And so this gives some information, but no description, neither in my paper nor in Atzman-Alevsky, no description of cyclic element for which functions it is cyclic. So some analog of outer or Pelli-Wiener condition of integrability of logarithm or something. No such kind results. So for lambda equal to n for the entire dilation, so lambda star is equal to logarithm of n, where n run over, this time lambda is equal to n, and so lambda star is from logarithm of n. And natural numbers. So there is some results. independently of Riemann, but maybe dependently, nobody knows. They are presented here, which are of interest for me. For example, for Poisson kernel, whose Fourier transform is the exponential, as you know, of the modulus, e to the power minus a modulus x. The Poisson kernel is cyclic with respect to logarithmic translation if and only if a is sufficiently large. So when it approaches to the real axis, there is no completeness. This is just the uniqueness theorem. For lambda n cyclicity, for arbitrary sequence lambda n, the criteria is found by Bruno Melnikov in 2007. It is much more involved than this Zalek result of 1981. And so if lambda star is an arbitrary sequence of reals, lambda n, then so necessary and sufficient conditions that there exists a cyclic function, but always there is no description, just the existence. Is that one also, of course, of the Blaschke type condition, but not for a half plane, but maybe for a strip here. In L1, the question is settled of the existence of cyclic function by Bruno Alevsky-Ulanovsky in 2006, who related this question with the Bernard-Malieven radius of completeness for completeness of exponentials. And they proved exactly that this is the same. I mean that given a sequence lambda n, there exists a L1 cyclic function with respect to these translations, if and only if the completeness Bernard-Malieven radius, I cannot define it, is infinite, which means that this is simple, which means that E lambda nx are complete in all in the space L2 minus AA for every A, for any interval. But Bernard-Malieven gave the geometric description of such kind sequences. And what is very intriguing and surprising, this is this Alevsky result of 97, which shows that this density result, that this approximation result is not the property of density of lambda n. It doesn't matter how many. No, it matters, but not so much. I mean that if you consider just n, there exists no cyclic function here, no even finite number of cyclic functions. I mean the finite family of functions which are finite, because this group has the infinite spectral multiplicity. But if you add very small an which tends to zero as rapid as you want, but different from zero to zero. Okay, so it is some, but as always, there is no description of the cyclic vectors. So these previous results gave some, maybe indicate some place of our dilation completeness results of Niemann or Baez-Duarte in the whole picture of translations. So now I'd like to comment the techniques used in Baez-Duarte proof, because this proof, I mean the proof of necessity, that if Riemann hypothesis is true, so you can approximate with the linear combination of entire dilation. Exactly this one is important if you want to disprove Riemann hypothesis, okay? Because in the other hand there is no hope, so no problem. I mean with this approach, with approximation approach. And this implication is important. And so it is based on this observation that the functions which participate in this approximation, phi and x, not this one, it's a function psi n x, which is the normalized, if you recall, the linear combinations of this function I denoted by A, and A naught, the linear combinations F such that F1 is equal to zero. And in this space, in this linear manifold, there is a natural family which generate, and this family is here. And the first and very simple observation, which is here with the computation, is that these functions are constant on the interval from 1k to 1k plus 1. It takes just this value, fraction part of k over n. And the function 1 is also belongs to this subspace of functions which are constant on this interval. So in our approximation problem, we can forget on the orthogonal complement and consider only this space of functions constant on these step functions with this basis here on the interval 0, 1. And it happens, and it was proved by Vasunin, who is here and can criticize me if I will have some mistake. So he proved in 95 that this family is minimal, which means, as you know, that there is a biorthogonal sequence of functions. The functions in the same subspace which satisfy this condition for every n and m, and so to any function f you can associate the formal Fourier transform, the formal Fourier series with respect to this, which can converge to this function or maybe not. This biorthogonal function is unique if and only if the system psi n is complete, which is not known, and which is exactly equivalent to the Riemann conjecture. Because not only the statement that I will write it separately. Not only the condition that the function 1 belongs to the span of Cn is equivalent to the Riemann conjecture, but also that and this is much easy and just observation that this span coincide with our L2 step 0, 1. So also some completeness result. And so we don't know whether this biorthogonal is unique, but however it is constructed. It is constructed by this formula using the Möbius inversion formula, which I was not, will not cite in its normal generality, but here we have some basic functions. You know, these factors are very simple. This is just to normalize this function on this interval, because the length of this interval, the measure is 1 over k plus 1. So to make this element, this function normalized, and so we have the difference of two neighbor normalized indicator functions, ik, this is the intervals of this partition, and so from the Möbius inversion form it follows that this system Fm is the bi-orthogonal. So you have already some instrument to trying to see, but I repeat that it's not necessary that this series converges. So not every generalized and even standard Fourier series converges. Okay, but it, however, because the goal is very interesting, so it was made much efforts to this trick. So this is the formal series of the function 1, which should be approximated. You compute scalar product, and it is obvious that all members of the sum disappears excepting the first one. And so this is the same Möbius function. I forget to say, to recall you what is Möbius function. Möbius function defined on n to r, it is for every p, it is equal to, for every prime p, it is equal to minus 1, for every prime square, it is equal to 0, and after it is multiplicative. So you take n, you take p1 alpha 1 and so on, ps alpha s, and you apply multiplicativity. So in particular, it is 0 on every integer which contains a square. It is divisible by a square number, so the Möbius is 0. So in particular, if this series converges to 1, so the approximation is possible not only by the function psi n, by all functions which contains no squares. So many functions you don't need it. So was make many properties, but the hope still exists, however, at the least. So first of all, the series converges to 1 in L1 by the same Bayes Duarte. Then a Korean mathematician Li proved that the convergence in LP plus epsilon for every epsilon is equivalent to the fact that the zero, the zeta function does not vanish for the real part bigger than 1 over p. So it shows also that this series is related, however, to Riemann conjecture. Can you use it to prove or to disprove? It is including p equal to 2. So including the Riemann conjecture at all. But for L2, however, it diverges. And we will show it. I will show this result later on. It diverges, and but moreover, it diverges, but assuming that Riemann conjecture, Riemann hypothesis is true, the same Bayes Duarte proved that the series is summable by a summation method, which is here. You consider not mu k psi k, but you smooth it with some factors, like how it's called. It's called like fair summation, not fair, but Dirichlet. Dirichlet, yes, I don't know. Anyway, so and to limit exist in the metric of L2, and then the limit exists in the metric in L2 when epsilon tends to zero. It is quite technical result, not enormously, but however, in particular, to prove there was not enough to use some standard knowledge about zeta function, and he improved a little bit the Littlewood theorem on the behavior of zeta function on the vertical lines in order to prove, but using the same using the same method. So that in view of these results, so it is in view of this summation method, you can see that however one belongs to the linear Hall of psi k, not necessarily for all k, but only for k which does not contain the squares. But how to make the approximation, not clear. Okay, I continue the comment of Baez-Duarte and Niemann results. So we will make the Millin transform and consider the statement after the Millin transform. So I computed this one, this formula, so I can show you the slide of the beginning, not slide, but what I wrote in the blackboard. In the first lecture, I proved this formula, which is the first one, and this one is absolutely obvious if you recall the definition of the Millin transform. Maybe I forget sometimes 1 over square root of 2 pi this is the definition, I recall it. And so this is obvious. And so if, and on the other hand, F star, so the Millin transform, is unitary operator from the L2 with respect to invariant measure on the half line to the real line. And so the Niemann theorem transform in the following, that Riemann hypothesis is equivalent to this one. Okay, because here you have this lambda, and you take the linear combinations, this will be this one, and so it says that the zeta function on the critical line is a cyclic function, anyway sufficient to approximate the constant function with this weight, with this Poisson weight, which is here. And the same for Baez-Duarte, of course, but the difference that you can consider not arbitrary frequency here, but only the natural one, and so it is called Dirichlet polynomials. So you the infimum is take over all Dirichlet polynomials, AK, this is the finite sums. Finite sums, and the infimum is make with respect to all these all exponential polynomials, and this one with respect to all on the real line, on the imaginary line, always. My question when I regarded these two results was the maybe absolutely trivial, but I not arrived in the answer. So. Because you consider of, I can say, the cyclicity of this function zeta on the critical line with respect to two algebra of multipliers, and algebras are different. The very simple trick to identify these two results is simply proved that the lesser algebra, this one, is weakly closed in the larger one, as say the disk algebra is weakly dense in H infinity. This is similar trick. I don't know. The objection with the theory of almost periodic function does not work, because I mean that you cannot change the frequencies if you approximate almost periodic functions in some norm. But this is not the norm, this weak convergence. Group of entire numbers is dense in the compact Bohr group, Bohr compactification. So it is the typical that the question is not in the frequencies. When you made the weak approximation, so it is right possible. I don't know how to do it and whether it is trivial or it seems not. It seems it's not trivial. I regarded it, say, not a night, but a half an hour, maybe more. So now, just one more point in the same direction, that the Baez-Duarte and Niemann result is not isolated. There is many result like this. I mean that you can take almost arbitrary function and its approximation will be equivalent to the Riemann conjecture. And this is here presented. So he started with the following operator P, which is here. So say for define this operator, you can suppose that F is has a compact support on the real line, then there is no problem of convergence, and this is so-called Euler difference operator. Why is it Euler difference operator? Because if you multiply this formula by x, so it will be the Riemann sum on the left-hand side. And the right-hand side, it will be the integral. And so Euler interested how, even if that it's not him who defined Riemann integral, but however, he interested when Riemann sums approach the integral of some continuous functions. So if we consider this Euler means and Poisson also considered it related to Poisson summation formula, which is very, very close to this matter. And so if it considered, you can remark two facts. First of all, what I mentioned already, we know this, that the Millin transform of the a fractional part of 1 over x, it is zeta over s. And the Millin transform of indicator function is 1 over s, which is trivial. And on the other hand, this is computable. So you can compute the Euler-Münz operator for indicator function of 0, 1. This is just this value. This is just this value, which is it is some misprint. It is not here. Just a second. What happens? What happens?
One over x is not in the sum.
It's something wrong. So it should be what? It should be just
okay.
Oh, it's okay, yeah?
Everything is okay.
Yeah. No, it's okay, yeah. So, this one is equal to, this one corresponds to the sum, it is just the entire part, and this is from integral, and this is just the fractional part of 1 over x, our key function, which we used in the proof. And so, the Münz formula, who is proved by Münz, in relation with the Riemann conjecture. So he considered also some activity around this, and he proved in particular this formula, which is known for us for the case of f equal to indicator function. It coincides with our formula, which is here. It is just the same. But he proved it with, in general, under some hypothesis and under some conjecture. And Baez Duarte, the same person, used this definition and this formula in order to prove that if f has the compact support and differentiable, and if no, what? Yeah. It's something. No, that if 0, 0, it means that it tends to 0 at 0 and at infinity, not finite support, not compact support, and satisfies this condition, integrability. And if the Millin transform does not vanish in the critical strip, then Riemann hypothesis is equivalent to this approximation. So the entire dilations. The function f can be approximated by entire dilation of the Euler-Münz transform if and only if the Riemann hypothesis holds. And the proof, in fact, make a combination, of course, of Niemann and Baez Duarte, and the previous Baez Duarte, and coincide with the proof given already for the case when f is equal to indicator function. Indicator function is not C1, but however, so this is general theorem, which gives many examples of functions whose approximation is equivalent to the conjecture, to the hypothesis, and this is one of the more of the most interesting example. So I'd like to say that this Niemann and Baez Duarte theorems, they are not isolated facts in the approximation theory, in the approximation approach to this arithmetics, but there is many others, and you can try to find counterexample trying different functions f. Okay? And now one more quite unexpected trick, which is also made by the same Baez Duarte. I don't know where he is now, because he was in principle in the University of Caracas in Venezuela, where all this disorder of the last time, and I don't know whether he so go out or not succeeded. It's very complicated. I was there once, and it was very, very long ago, but even in this quiet time, there was the machine gun in the entrance to the university, in the both side. So you go there and with the guard. Okay, so however, because he has no activity in the last time, so his publication stopped, to my knowledge, in 2007 or something like this, maybe 2010. Okay, so let's consider the dilation invariant isomorphism, or first of all, operators. It means that we consider the operator, bounded linear operator from L2 to L2, which is which commute with all dilations. Dilations are not isometric on the in the L2 with respect to Lebesgue measure, but however they are bounded and almost isometries, but not. However, we are, this is a group of operators, and we consider operators which commute. So if we transport this operator with the help of multiplication x 1/2 to the L2 with respect to invariant measure, so it will be also an operator which commute with the dilations. And this time, so we can use the Millin-Planchirel transform, Millin-Fourier, and say that this operator is a multiplier, Fourier-Millin multiplier or convolutor. This is a convolution on this group, multiplicative group, with some distribution such that it Millin transform is a bounded function, theta, which is called the symbol. Okay? And so this Millin transform of this operator, this is, which is the operator bounded from L2 to L2 on the imaginary axis, is just a multiplication operator. This symbol is unique, it always exists, and in this notation it is clear when the invariant operator is an isomorphism of the space L2, or say unitary operator, because it is unitarily equivalent to this multiplication, and the multiplication is invertible if and only if the function theta is invertible, bounded at 1 over theta, bounded on unimodular, or unimodular if we speak about the unitarity of the operator. Okay, and so his principal observation, which is very sharp, consists that there exists a unitary multiplier, so with unimodular theta, such that which transform, yeah, but what is important that it is clear that translation invariant operator is uniquely defined by its value on just one function, but if this function is a cyclic function with respect to translation, it is clear, because we can apply T to the translations of H. Translation is permutable, so it will be translation of the same function, and because the translations of F of H is generate the space, so we obtain the same operator. So if we speak about translation invariant operator, it's sufficient to define it only to on one function, but it should be a cyclic function with respect to this group of translation. Okay, and so he proved that there exists a unitary multiplier which transform the fractional part 1 over x in the fractional part of x multiplying by 1 over x to have this, the integrability at infinity. Okay, and he computed the symbol, which is of course, because this function and its Millin transform, it related to zeta, and T is the dilation invariant, so it is clear that zeta should appear. It appears, and this is the formula, this is unimodular function, and the values in symmetric points with respect to the critical line, and even the explicit formula he found here. The integral may be not convergent, but it is defined as usual as for Fourier-Planchirel transform. So you need to take from epsilon to 1 over epsilon on finite interval, and then tends epsilon to 0, and it is proved that there is a L2 convergence, and in this sense, so this formula holds true. So using this formula and this very clever observation, he mentioned that so he applied this, because the operator is unitary, so it preserves all. And so he applied this operator to Neeman and to his own theorem, and obtained that Riemann hypothesis is equivalent to the following approximation: that this sign, which is the T-transform of the indicator function, which is easy from the last formula here. From the last formula, it is easy. And so if we multiply by the square root of x the first line, so we will obtain the second line. Okay, and so we obtain first time what is my goal in this introduction. I not finished already introduction. When I will treat the subject, I don't know. So, but introduction is very close to be finished. Because we arrived in periodic function, which is important for me, for the rest of these lectures, that we have a family of periodic function, one periodic function this time. And we need to approximate something in some norms. Unfortunately, the norms are not what I want. The norm is not the L2 norm, but the weighted L2 norm. Because there is some, when you pass, you divide by, you multiply by x, and to keep the isometry, so the x square appears here. And the result was independently observed by Habsiger and Volodya Kapustin, who is here, and with much more details and much more interesting things, but I cannot include it in my list because I have no time. So, in particular, he showed, Bayes Duarte showed, that his this operator T, which he constructed in this theorem, gives the proof of the divergence of Vasionian series, which I mentioned. Because, so if the series converges, so its T-transform converges. And so the T-transform of the partial sums are bounded. But the partial sums are here with this fractional part minus 1 over k fractional part of 1 over x, which is bounded easily. So I related it, and so this sum should be bounded if the Vasionian series converges in L2. So he applied his unitary operator. He obtained not 1 over kx, but what? So 1 over this fractional part has this one, so the dilation kx will give 1 over kx, because it is invariant, it is permutable with the dilation. So we will obtain this one. And then, so we integrate not on the interval 0 infinity, but just to the very, very small part of it. Here, all kx are fractional. So the fractional part is equal to kx. It disappears. And it's still this one. And there is a classical result by Titchmer that this sequence is not bounded. It does not tend to infinity, but is not bounded. And so it is not so easy theorem, but in particular it is contained in Titchmer's book I quoted in the beginning of the first lecture. And I'm sorry, what happened? it seems that I choose not the good file to show on the screen. Just a second. What is written here? Yeah. No, but nothing wrong. Don't say so. It is okay. So, of course. So this one, this is some information and some speculation, which I talk already about. But what is quite new? So the quotation of from the Norman Livingston paper, the famous footnote, which disappointed all believer in approximation approach to the Riemann conjecture, but not us in these lectures, because I told from the beginning that this is not for the proof. What he told here in this sentence, but the approximation approach is for disproof, and don't and so it is not. Okay, so now I approach to the principal theme, to the principal subject of this series of lectures. The dilation completeness problem. The dilation completeness problem, it is here in general, and even maybe if you want, I stated it in more general form, but here I will concentrate up to until the rest. For the whole resting time, I will concentrate my attention on the case when the dilations are integers in time. Okay, and so the problem is in the following: given a function from LP, we consider the restrictions of the dilations on the interval 0, 1, and the problem is when it is complete or not in the space LP. So the elementary examples like this one, sine, which will give the orthonormal basis, or the exponentials, or the exponentials of lower order, with this restriction will give the complete dilations. And if the order is bigger, it will give not complete dilations, which is the both are also related to Bleschke condition, because you write the orthogonality relation and you estimate your function with the free parameter in place of integer n here, which appear explicitly in this orthogonality relation, and you apply after some preparations the Bleschke uniqueness theorem, which gives these results. With it's very strange things always around zeta function happens. In particular, in very long ago, in 1944 and 45, two famous mathematicians start independently the same program without nothing saying about Riemann zeta function. Because, so I can say you what we will see. So we are arrived in the approximation by one periodic function in the space with the weights 1 over x square. If we can prove, so this is a dilation, dn, okay? Dn in this space, it is not isometry, but almost isometry. I think that I will make no mistake. Well, what we can say, if I say that this is isometry, no? Or on times square root of n. So something like this. One of this one is an isometry on this space. And this isometry, of course, satisfies the commutation or even multiplicativity relation here. Like this, Tn, Tm is a T with the product of, so this is the representation of the multiplicative group, semigroup of integers in the operator space. What I need, you will see why, so I will show it. What we need to show that the problem of Winter and Burling is equivalent to the Riemann hypothesis is the following, that there exists an orthonormal basis, EK, in this space, such that Tn Ek is E K of n with some function K of n. That's all. But not clear. In general, if you have the commuting family of isometries, say T P, we can consider prime numbers P1 equal to 2, P2 equal to 3, and so on, Pj, all prime numbers, and we can consider these isometries, which satisfy some multiplicative property, but at least they commute. And so if we we consider even arbitrary, not necessarily this one, the family of isometries in a Hilbert space, we satisfy this condition and which appear, so T, P, K, H intersection is zero for every P, so every this isometry is a pure shift of certain multiplicity. So whether in this case there exists such kind of basis, we satisfy this one. There is an example, of course, when this is the case, and for instance, so you consider TnF of z on the unit circle for polynomials f of z to the n, okay, and so no problem. You have T n z k is equal to z n k, and you are done. And so to include, to connect this problem of Winter and Burling to Riemann hypothesis, not by the spirit of this problem, but formally. So I need this property. Maybe it's wrong, huh? But however, the spirit still exists, and it is related to. Oh, it's okay, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So this will be our problem for the last lecture. I mean, so I will consider very specific part of the general dilation completeness problem only for two periodic function. Why two and one? It is nothing. It is just a periodic function, and the problem of completeness of the entire dilations. And what is the period is not so important. But here, so exactly, you can use the Fourier decomposition, the orthonormal basis here, and you will obtain the semigroup and this basis which plays the role of EK. But I will enter it in much more details in Saturday. So thank you.